So guys, today we have been starting with the center limit theorem. So I told you about the center limit theorem is the average of the samples will follow a normal distribution even if they have been collected from a population that is not normally distributed. So this is a thing we have discussed yesterday and now as well. So now all these things which I've been telling you, hypothesis testing, normal curve, center limit theorem, all these are applicable on continuous data. Discrete data won't be suitable for any of the scenario which we have just discussed. With me? Okay. Now, let me tell you one thing. So let me do an exercise. So I am writing some data randomly.
Screen is not visible.
Screen is not visible.
Oh, okay, I guess it has gone. Is it visible now?
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Just now be with me for 5 minutes. I have been preparing a data for you to perform a certain tests. So be with me, okay? I'm just writing it on Excel. Be on the screen. I'm on mute. Okay.
Sir, one request here.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
It would be very helpful if you, get the data from the internet and explain it so that we can aware of that real-time example rather than preparing our own data, sir.
Yeah, you're right. So basically, when that particular thing will come, like machine learning model development and all these things, I'll do that only. But now I've been just taking a random data, which even you will get it in 2 seconds. Just be with me. So I'll show you. Okay, I'll say V1, V2 is equal to I have taken a random between 10 to 100, random values is equal to (22, 130). Okay. Sorry, am I audible? So what I've done is I have just typed the formula, ran between 10 to 100 and is equal to ran between 20 to 130. Copied it and pasted it till for 30 iterations. I've copied and pasted the same for 30 iterations. Now you can also do that in your Excel sheets. I'm here only waiting for you to complete, and I'll start. Mm. Please let me know if all of you are done. Yeah, please let me know once you are done, and I'll continue this. Once this data preparation is done with you guys.
Done, sir.
Everybody done? Or do you need 1 or 2 more minutes?
Sir,
everybody?
Sir, 2 minutes, please.
Okay. Take your time.
Done, sir.
Okay. So now what I do is take this data and paste it somewhere else. Okay, in column AD or whatever. Now, the problem is we have a vendor, that is vendor V1, his name is V1. So I work for a farmer, and what actually farmer wants that I actually want to purchase apples from the market, from the different farmers, and I will sell it off. And my apples are actually not useful if the average weight of an apple is less than 50 or 55 grams. Am I with you? Are you with me? Sorry. Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir.
So
one second, please.
So actually, we work for a fruit selling company, and what we do, we purchase apples from certain farmers, and we sell them off with the higher prices, or we make some product out of it. But the apple, which is less than, if the average weight of the apples is less than 55 grams. Then the apples are not worth using it for us. The average weight should be 55 gram. If the average weight of the apples falls less than 55 grams, then these apples does not meet our requirement. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir. Let me write it down for everybody.
We need to have average weight.
Yeah. Okay. So now we have collected this data from any one of the vendor, that is vendor one. And how many apples we need? We need, say, 1 lakh apples. We need how many apples?
1 lakh.
We need 1 lakh apples. Now in this 1 lakh apples, we have asked the vendor. We have been testing the vendor. So we have asked the vendor to supply us these apples. Now the vendor one came with a certain samples. 30 samples he has given us. We have seen that the average weight is 57 grams, which is 55, more than 55. So now we have two things in our mind considering the sample. One is H0. Second is HA. Zero says the average weight of apple of the population is equal to, so average weight of population apple is equal to 50 gram. Weight is not equal to 50 grams. So I'll tell you what is less than greater than, don't worry about that. But consider if it is 55, sorry. Or say 57 grams, and it is not 57 grams. And we actually want the average weight of the apples to be 5 till now.
Sir, actually this 57 gram is the mean of our samples. Is it?
So, yeah. The condition is we actually want the average weight of the apples which are being supplied by the vendor needs to be weighed as 57 grams average.
Then sir, okay. What is the requirement for us? Average apple. Weight of apple should be 5 grams.
57 grams.
To be greater than 57 grams.
To be greater than or equal to. You say average weight of the apple should be equal to 57 grams. Okay. Or you can say it as a average weight of a coin. There is a specific kind of a steel metal. So I'll change it. The thing is, we need to have the average weight of.
Sir, we want samples. You have mentioned, right? It's the weight or the number count.
Weight.
Okay.
So, can you please repeat the example because it's very confusing?
Okay. The thing is, what we actually need, we are basically a steel ball manufacturing company. So we actually want the average weight of the steel ball to be 57 gram. Else we won't be able to make a bearing. Okay, this is the condition. So we have asked the vendor, we actually need 1 lakh steel balls. We have asked the vendor to supply us the balls and ask for an initial sample. Vendor came with this sample and the average weight can be seen. It is actually 57 grams only. Okay. So now there are two conditions that will come to my mind. One is population average is also equal to 57 gram or population average is not equal to 57 gram. So if it is more than 57 gram, then also it is a problem for us. If it is less than 57 gram, then also it is a problem for us.
Okay, sir.
Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now let me write it down.
Sorry, sir. The voice is breaking in the middle. What happens if the average weight is more than 57 or less than 57, sir?
So the product that we will be making with it. So in every product that we make, if the average weight of the steel balls goes more than 57 grams, so if we have been making, we are in any of the product, we need to put 1 lakh steel balls with the average weight of 57 grams. 57. Multiplied by this So if the weight crosses 57,000, then the product won't be able to carry that much of the weight. If it is less than 57,000, then product, there is high chances that product damages very easily. Are you guys with me?
Yeah, okay.
So the weight should be equal to 57 gram only. Some decimals here and there are fine. If the weight crosses more than 57 gram average, then like the product that we will be making will be getting heavier and the product won't be able to carry that much of it. And if it is less, then there is chances that product like vanishes bitterly as expected. So let me write it down for your better understanding.
Sir, yeah. If the sample, out of all the sample, if our average weight is coming out to be 57 grams, then our problem is solved, right?
So how do you think that whatever the vendor is supplying as a sample, the population weight, we don't have the mechanism to actually weigh the 1 lakh, 10 lakh or whatever things steel balls. We don't have that mechanism. We don't have those many resources. I work with only 5 workers in the factory. So I don't have the enough manpower to weigh each and every steel ball and all the things. So we have asked the vendor to give us a sample. Now with the sample only, we need to evaluate whether the population that the vendor will be supplying, we actually need to judge. So it's not an exact kind of a thing that will come, but it will be an approximation through hypothesis testing that will come, whether we will accept this load or we will not accept this load. Based on the sample only.
Okay, so you mean to say the sample weight that is coming out to be 57 gram, we are not trusting with that and we are performing inferential statistics with it.
Yeah, we are going with inferential statistics just to see if like the weight of the steel balls of the population will also be equal to 57 or not.
Okay.
So this will not provide you the exact answer, but this will give you a guidance.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So just give me a minute. I will write it down. Just give me a minute. I'm just holding you for 1 minute. Okay. So now what we need to do is we need to see whether the average weight is more than 57 grams.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
I just joined just now. Can you please tell me in brief what have we covered so far in the class?
We have covered the center limit theorem and now we have been working on one of the problem of hypothesis testing, live problem.
Okay.
So the problem is we have taken the samples and we actually expect we don't have the resources to measure the entire population. So we actually expect the average weight of the population to be 57 gram of the steel balls example that we have been taking. In case it exceeds 57 gram, then it is a problem for the product that we have been making. In case it is less than average 57 gram, then also it is a problem. So we actually wanted it to be exact 57 gram. So one of the live example will be, so you see a cold drink bottle. A cold drink bottle is always 500 ml filled. If it is more than 500 ml filled, then it is a loss of the drink that has been there. If it is less than 500 ml, then it's a loss of reputation. So our problem is also similar to that. So we have been taking 57 grams. So now we have asked a vendor to supply us a material, a sample. Vendor has given us a sample of 30, where the weight is coming to be 57 gram only. Okay, it is 57 gram. Now actually wanted to see whether the entire population will also be carrying a similar kind of a weight or not. So we don't have the population right now. We don't have the resources to evaluate the population. So we have two conditions in our mind. One is the average weight of the population is also equal to 57 gram. And second condition is average weight of the population is not equal to 57 grams. So now what I'll do is I'll go to data analysis. In case this data analysis tab is not coming to your Excel, so can you check if this is coming on your Excel as well, data analysis tab?
No, sir.
Then go to file. Go to options. Go to add-ins. Select the analysis tool pack from your inactive applications and click on go. First click on go, then click on OK.
Yes, so now it's coming.
Everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now, what is this analysis tool pack? What is this analysis tool pack?
We'll give graphs this, and all.
So this analysis tool pack is a thing that has been provided by Excel for a certain kind of analysis that we can do. I'll show you. So you can do all these analysis. Earlier, it has been 5-7 years. This capability is available in Excel. Earlier, this capability was not available in Excel. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So now what we will do is I'll go to actually when we work on
inferential not present.
When we work on inferential statistics, so whenever we need to check for one mean means we have been checking for one mean. So this one sample we have been checking for one sample hypothesis testing. For one sample mean. So right now the problem which I have taken is one sample mean. Because I have a one sample only. One sample. That is sample from vendor one only. When we have this kind of a thing, we apply one sample t test. Whenever we have hypothesis testing for two sample means, then we say,
sir, I'm not able to understand what is one sample mean and two sample mean.
So right now I have a single vendor that is supplying us the material.
Yes.
Now let's example the second data which I have taken. will bring into the picture. Another vendor is also supplying us the material. Now, if we want to see whether the average weight that is has been supplied by vendor one is equal to the average weight that has been supplied by the vendor two, then it comes for a two sample mean test. Are you with me?
Means mean for both vendors is same.
Mean for both vendors are same. So let's example, I'll revise the situation. So yeah, just let me cover this first one, then I'll explain you the second one. So the thing is, when we have a single sample available, then it is known as one sample t-test. If you want to, okay, let me tell you what it is. So let me first tell you how it works. So I'll take an example, because one sample t-test is not available in Excel data analysis. So let me say the condition is still say 57 gram. I have been taking it from always the vendor one, who has been supplying it and giving it as a 57 gram only. Now this vendor one does not have capability to provide me the entire load. He said, sir, my friend will supply you the entire load. I said, okay, but the condition is whatever weight you have been supplying to me, I actually want the vendor, your friend vendor, to supply me of the same weight. Okay. He said, okay, sir, the weight will be exactly same for the vendor two who will be supplying. Okay. Now I asked the sample for the vendor two, but it is coming to 79 gram. So I said, no, the weight of the vendor one and the vendor two sample weight is not same. But the vendor one said, sir, it's only because of sample, but when the entire load will come, it is same only. So did you get the second problem?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now the condition will be, this is for one sample. This condition was for one sample. Now for two sample, the condition is average weight of V1 equal to V2. Now, second is average weight of V1 not equal to V2 are the two conditions that will test. If I'll be going with the one sample test, then I'll test average weight is equal to 57 gram, average weight not equal to 57 gram. If two sample test, average weight of vendor one is equal to vendor two, average weight of vendor one is not equal. Are you with me?
Sir,
yes.
This is one part.
Yes, sir.
Plus, we also have to find whether the average weight is equal to 57 grams or less than or greater than.
So first is we need to check whether the average weight is 57 or not 57. Second is assume that it came equal to 57. In the first test, it is equal to 57. Okay. Now, the second problem came when one won't be able to supply the entire material. We are happy with the weights he have been supplying. That is equal to 57 gram. We have tested it and it's working fine. Now he came up with another vendor and he said, sir, the weight which vendor two will be supplying will also be 57 gram, which will also be equal to the weight which I have been supplying all the time. Okay. So for the second condition, I made this. Is it fine?
Yes.
Everybody.
Yes, sir. Correct me if I am wrong. Actually, if we have one vendor, means we need to find the average weight and go for the one sample t-test, mm-hmm, and check whether the weight is equal to 57 or not, and if it is not equal to 57 or not. If we have two vendors, we need to check, go for the two sample t-test, and check whether the weight, average weight of vendor one is equal to vendor two. And second condition is average weight of vendor one is not equal to average weight of vendor two. Is that right, sir?
Yes, you are absolutely bang on. So that's the thing which I have.
Okay.
Everybody agree with, what's your good name?
It's Muthu, sir.
So everybody agree with what Muthu is saying. So I guess if everybody has the same understanding what Muthu has, then I'm fine to proceed as I'm fine to proceed.
Yes, sir.
So please explain two sample mean again.
Muthu, can you please tell again the statement which you just said?
Yeah, sure. Actually, if you have one vendor, samples from one vendor means we go for the one sample t-test and measure the average weight of average weight and check the conditions whether the weight is equal to average weight or not, and weight is not equal to average weight or not. So this is for the samples collected from the one vendor. If you have samples collected from two vendors, let's say V1 and V2, we go for the two sample t-test and check the condition. First condition as weight of average weight of vendor one is equal to vendor two. The second condition as average weight of vendor one is not equal to average weight of vendor two.
Yeah. So let me reiterate this. So earlier the problem was we have a single vendor. So we have newly started a business. We have a single vendor. We said I actually need the weight of 57. He has been supplying me the weights and I'm fine. Like it's actually 57 gram all the time. So, okay. So this was this first condition that has been met. Let's assume this first condition has been met. Now with time, this vendor one does not have capability to supply me 1 lakh balls, or in case my demand is increased from 1 lakh to 10 lakh, this vendor one does not have capability to supply me these 10 lakhs balls. So he has introduced me with the vendor two and he said, sir, he also knows me, the vendor too, and he will supply you the weight which I have been supplying all the time. Then I will say the null condition is average weight of the vendor one is equal to vendor two, and the average weight of vendor one is not equal to vendor two is the second condition which I'll be testing. Is it fine?
Okay, sir.
For this first condition, I'll be going with one sample t-test. For these two second condition, I'll be going with two sample t-test. So I'll write it there. When I need to check this kind of a thing, I will go with one sample t-test. Whenever I need to check the conditions like this, I need to go with two sample t-test. Is it fine?
So why it is called t-test?
Yeah, I'll tell you. Don't worry, I'll tell you.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Anybody saying anything?
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, it means the vendor two, it depends on the vendor one.
Yeah, because it depends, it totally depends on the vendor one, because we actually want to see whether the weights are equal or not. If the weights are not equal, then it is a problem.
So suppose, sir, if we have a more number of vendors, then we will also compare with vendor one only now.
So then we will go with another test that is known as ANOVA. And similar is the condition. If it is more than, okay, let me not explain now, but I'll tell you later. Okay. Yeah. So we will go with the vendor one only. And so let's example now with time, the business further, our business further grown. Instead of 10 lakh balls, we need 100,000 balls. Now these vendors introduce us with another two vendors, three vendors. So the condition is vendor one equal to vendor two equal to vendor three, or vendor one or any one of the vendor is not. Okay, that is the condition that come. Am I right? So I'll let you know later. I'll tell you later. So because if I'll tell this thing right now, the people will get confused. So till now, these are the two conditions. Are we fine with these two conditions?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So now everybody, so anybody has any doubt, please let me know, because after this, I'm just going with the practical example of hypothesis testing. If it is not clear, then I'm fine to repeat 10 more times. I'm fine. But in case it is not clear, then please don't let me go. Please hold me here only. Do I repeat again or I proceed?
Yes, sir. Please repeat.
So one sample t-test is whenever we have one vendor and we actually want to measure whether the weight is actually 57 gram or not, then I'll go with one sample t-test where I will say the weight is 57 gram, the first condition, and second is weight is not equal to 57 gram, and we will test it with the hypothesis. Second is, let's example, the first condition went fine, the vendor weight is 57 gram only, and now we have introduced another vendor which we want to test whether the weight that has been provided by the new vendor is equal to vendor one or is not equal to vendor are the two conditions which I have to check. So now let me tell you, I'll go to data. I'll go to data analysis. So here there is a condition that is known as two sample t-test. T-test, two sample, assuming unequal variance I am taking. I'll tell you why. I'll tell you, don't worry. So I've been checking the second condition right now, whether the weight of vendor one and vendor two supplies are equal or not. So I mentioned you, we will go with two sample t-test. So I am saying t-test two sample. I'll tell you what is equal and what is unequal variance. I'm taking the one, okay? So I said, okay. Now I'll say, what is the variable one? What is the vendor one? I'll say, this is the vendor one. Now I'll say, what is the vendor two? I'll say, this is the vendor two. Okay. Are we guys here only, or we have lost?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Sir. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now the thing is, what we actually want. So every statistic won't we tell you with 100% confidence. So if stats will say 100% confidence, this means go and measure the population. The stats always says I cannot be 100% confident. Okay. So we said, okay, be 95% confident with 5% error. This alpha is error. I'll tell you what is this alpha after this, but be with me. I'll say, okay, stats, tell me with 95% confidence, and I want my output. Say here. Okay, I'll say okay. The stats is working and providing us the output. This is the output that came. This is the output that came. Now, how to interpret this output? How to interpret this output? Okay, is the thing I've been telling you with a slogan. Okay, first of all, are we clear till what I have done in Excel right now? I'm not talking about getting the output and understanding the output, but are we clear till now?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, sir.
So
yes, sir.
Yeah, yes, sir. To understand what stats is saying. So, okay, how many of you have dog at your home?
Sir, I have.
You have. What's your good name?
Dhruv, sir.
Dhruv. So Dhruv, when your dog barks, will you be able to understand, is he barking because he is looking for food, he is hungry, or he is barking because he actually wants to go outside?
Sir, this is partially sometimes I'm able to understand, because if it is, it's time to give him the lunch or the dinner, then and if he is barking at that very moment, then it is understandable. And many at times he just wants to bark.
So you understand that many of the times he just wants to bark, and some of the times he is barking for a particular thing he is actually need. So you understand him. Okay. Why you understand him? Because you have been with this dog for say 2-3 or whatever years you have. Why I took this example? Because statistics, dog has a language to pass your thing that he is barking, which means he needs something. In a similar way, stats also has a way to communicate. Now it's up to you whether you will understand or no. I will give you a slogan to understand this stats, what this stats is trying to say. So I have been giving you a slogan. In the same way, Dhruv understands what the dog says. So I am giving a slogan with the help of which you can understand what this statistical summary is saying. Okay. So I'll say slogan is, if P is high, okay, higher than what the error value that we have taken, 0.05, null must fly, which means fly means accepted. If P is low, low means less than 0.05, I'll say null must go, which means rejected. Okay, this is
so at it zero. Would be better that if you provide the symbol rather than high or low. What is this confusion?
Okay, P is high, which is if P is greater than 0.5, or P is low means less than 0.5. Okay, so now whatever this stats is saying, so we have two conditions, H0 means null, second is HA means alternate. So this stat is saying if P is high, null must fly. If P is higher than 0.05, then accept the null hypothesis. If P is low, lower than 0.05, then reject the null hypothesis. So that's the stat saying. Okay.
So what about if P is equal to 0.05?
Yeah. Yeah, P is, I'll come to that, but when it is P equal to 0.5, then we need to change the confidence level. I'll tell you this later on. But did everybody understand what I have been trying to say with this slogan?
Yes.
How to interpret the statistical summary that has came out?
Sir?
Yeah.
No,
sir, it is understandable what it is being taught here, but what would be the output that I'm not able to relate actually?
Yeah. So I haven't told you till now. So once I will be telling you, then you will be able to get it. So I'm in the midway of it. So did you get it till the midway? If you say yes, then I'll take you to the end route. If you say no, then I will go again to start.
Yes, sir. Understood by now.
Okay, so I got the, so step one was, I have the data. Yeah. Anybody saying anything?
Yes, sir. Please repeat this high and low notification.
So we have a statistical summary that came out. Now we have a slogan. This slogan is universal. So even if on Google, if I'll say, so this slogan will come. You have to remember this slogan. So there is nothing to understand this. Okay, just give a second. See, if P is high, null must fly. If P is low, null must go. If P is less, so everywhere you will find this slogan. I'll go to images. If P is low, null must go. If P is high, null must fly. If P is low, null must go. If P is high, null must fly. So this is a slogan which you need to remember, but I'll tell you how to use this slogan. Okay. Whenever the statistical output comes, go for this value. Don't ask like why not one tail, because I will tell you later. Go with this value, two tail, highlight this value. This value as well. Okay. Now, what is this value? 0.007. So, is P higher? Is this a P value? This is a P value. Is this P value higher than 0.05 or less than 0.05?
Less than.
is so less.
P is, this means P is low, null must go, which means null should be rejected. If null should be rejected, then alternate should be accepted. That is average weight that is being supplied by vendor 1 and vendor 2 will not be equal in the population with 95% confidence. So that's a message which statistics has given us.
Got it, sir.
Anybody who wants me to repeat?
Yes, sir, repeat.
Yes, sir, repeat it, sir.
Okay. So I have taken 2 samples, vendor 1, vendor 2. I want to judge whether the weights that have been supplied by the vendor 1 and vendor 2 are equal or not equal. Stefan, clear?
Yes, sir.
Sir, we have take, yeah.
So here only I have that problem that what if it is equal or not equal, suppose, but then how it is relating with how it is affecting the population, or like that 1 lakh balls. That is what I'm not getting.
So, how it is related. So let's example, you go to purchase something for your house, something for your home. Let's example, you go to purchase anything for your home where you need the average weight to be 57 grams. Okay. Now you need 1 lakh, 10 lakh, 1 crore pieces. But when you weigh them, 30 sample, it is coming to be 57 gram. But when you come home and you ask them to supply 1 crore sample at my home, and when they come, they are not 57 gram, they are say 40 grams. So this is a thing which we have been trying to solve with this hypothesis testing. So the weights, the supplies which these two vendors are giving, we just wanted to see if the when the population, when the 1 crore samples will come from these two vendors, will they also be weighing equal or not? Or it's just because of the sampling error. Did you get me?
So sir, these two vendors are giving me 1 lakh of steel balls.
So these two vendors will give me 1 lakh of steel balls, but at that point of time, I don't have the capability to measure the weight of 1 lakh balls or yes. 1 crore balls.
Yes.
So that's why I've been taking up 30 balls from each or 100 balls or whatever sample you want to. And I've been measuring the weights of those 100 balls. And I've been trying to estimate if they will supply me, when they will supply me 1 crore balls each, will these weights will still be equal or not?
Okay, so sir, you mean to say that if both the vendors' average weight is not coming same, that means that they are not going to provide me with 1 lakh steel balls.
No, they. So I will make the decision if with the hypothesis testing the stats will say no, this will not be equal to the vendor 1 weight will not be equal to vendor 2 when the population is being supplied. Then this will help me in decision making.
Okay, so that means that this will not give my requirement that we want our average ball weight to be 57 grams.
So in this situation, I won't be giving the chance to vendor 2 that because my statistical expert has made some test and he is 95% sure that the weight of the balls that you will be supplying will not be of equal to the weight of vendor 1.
Okay, sir. Understood now. Okay, so this is what we have been trying to do with 2 sample t-test.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anybody else, any doubt?
Sir, what about vendor 1? Like, what will be his average?
Yeah, I'll come to that because that capability is not available in Excel. So I need to explain with some programming tool. You don't see any 1 sample t-test here. So that's why I need to come to 2 samples, as I would have explained the 1 sample first.
Sir, do we not do you need to do this in Python?
Yeah, we can. So because if I'll start doing it in Python right now, so 80% of the audience will be lost.
Because we'll be doing it while doing the ML, right?
Yeah. We will be definitely doing it. But right now, I'm just explaining the concepts. I'm just taking you for a short walk where you have been learning how to walk. If I'll ask you to run, then 80% of you won't be able to go with me.
Okay. So, sir, what would have happened if P was high? Then what would have been the output?
If P is high, then we'll say if p is high, null must fly. Then we accept the null hypothesis. That the wage, average weight of vendor 1 is equal to one.
Sir, that means here p value is low. That means both the variables are independent of each other. That means no dependency of.
No. Don't go with that. So that is independence and mutually exclusive and exclusive are the different things. So that are the conditions, not the outcomes. So here, take it as an example where I have been measuring the weights of vendor 1 and vendor 2 only. So are the weights equal or not? So they can be independent, they can't be independent. This will be with the vendor 1 and the vendor 2 only. But for me as a business, I just need to understand whether the weights they have been supplying is equal or not. If P is high, higher than 0.05, then I will say null must fly. Null is accepted. I will simply go with this statement. I'll say accepted. But now in this condition, P is low. Null must go. So I will say stats is saying, so I will, null must go means I will reject this and I will accept this state. In this scenario, I will say vendor 2. I guess with the help of my statistics, I'm 95% sure you won't be able to meet the weights, the weight, but vendor 1 is. So that's it. Keep it simple.
Okay, sir.
So are you fine with the slogan? So do you want me to repeat the steps again?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So here yes, the sir. Two sample means the two sample, like necessarily it doesn't have to be like from two different vendors. Like from 1 lakh steel balls also we can take two samples of 30 data points. Can we do that?
In case they have been produced from different machines, in case they have been produced in different factories, in case they have been produced with two different conditions, then you can take.
Okay.
Anybody, any doubt till now?
So correct me if I'm wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So by doing this hypothesis, we can make a decision that V1 and V2 not equal. That's it.
Yeah, you're right. So even we won't be able to make the decision, but this will help us in making the decision.
Okay.
5% of error is still there.
Means hypothesis is not exactly 100%. We actually already assume that 5% error will happen.
Yeah, if you want to increase it to 100%, then hypothesis testing will come back to us and say, go and evaluate each and every, go and evaluate the population.
Okay, sir.
Sir, in the business perspective, if both the vendors are not equal to the expected average weight, so we need to think for some other vendors, the real time.
Yeah. So we are in this situation, in any of the general situation, if we've been getting it from vendor one, we are satisfied with the vendor one. And let's say example, so in normal scenario as well. So I'll tell you what will be the scenario. Let's say example, you have been taking output from a particular machine. Particular machine is giving you certain output. Suddenly you introduce another machine. You want to see whether the output that is being given by the you are very happy with output of machine 1, and now you want to see whether the output that has been given by the machine 2 is actually equal to machine 1 or not. So what you will do? So let's example. You will take a output from machine 2 and perform a hypothesis testing. So this is a thing which we normally do in a real life as. So let's example, we get a rice. We get rice. Okay. So we go to a vendor, say a grocery shop. There we find there are two bags of rice. So he says this rice is 80 rupees kg and second rice is 90 rupees kg. Both are put in the different bags. So we take both the rice in our hand and we compare those. Don't we do that?
Yes, sir. We do.
We do that. So in case the vendor one says the grocery owner or the departmental store owner says that these are the two rice, both are 80 rupees kg. Then you will take both the rice in your hand and you will compare. If both are 80 rupees kg, then what is the difference? Okay, so is the rice from the bag one is equal to the rice of the bag two? That's the thing that we do all the time.
Yeah.
So in many scenarios we do that. So if we are happy with the output from machine one, and we installed a machine two as well because the production is not being met. So what we do, we actually see whether the machine two is producing, is it equal to machine one or not. Okay, we take some balls in hand, we measure it. So same is the scenario. It can be vendor, it can be machine, it can be anything in this world.
Okay. The thing I am asking is same quality and the same same rice is given in the lowest cost for some other shop, means we obviously go for the
So let's example here, vendor two is a new vendor that has been introduced, and he's saying that I will give you the same thing at lower cost. Then I will say whether the weight of vendor one and vendor two is equal. If it would have said equal, then I would have rejected vendor one and accepted vendor, not rejected, I would have started taking the supplies from the vendor two, because he's supplying us with the less cost.
Yes, sir. But actually the thing is, we have 95% of accuracy and 5% of error. So yeah, we taken into account that error as well, or we simply go take a decision based on the output?
No. We don't go simply with the decision. What hypothesis testing is saying, it's just an enabler. It's not a thing which will ask you to take 100% decision basis. That stat is saying 95% confident means 95% confident. 5% is the error or the risk which you will be taking in case you are believing the hypothesis. It's just an enabler, so which is helping you to solve a problem. It is not a thing which is actually like helping you to so it is helping you to make the decision. It is not asking you to take the decision.
Okay.
With me?
Yes, sir.
Now, okay, anybody, any doubt till now? Because these concepts are actually very crucial and very important. So whenever you go anywhere in the statistics, you actually need to find out, you will be asked about hypothesis all the time. What is null hypothesis? What is alternate hypothesis? What if we have two samples? What if we have one sample? Which test we apply? So now, like after this, I will tell you what is. So why I'm not telling you T right now, because when I'll go to distributions, then I will tell you T is a, as yesterday we have covered normal distribution. Normal distribution is known as Z distribution. There's another distribution that is not Z, but it is known as T distribution. So that is T distribution. And in a similar term, we have many more chi-square distribution. We have many more distributions. Once we will cover the Poisson distribution, binomial distribution, exponential distribution, hypersymmetric distribution, Weibull distribution, we have many more distributions. So that's why I'm not going to tell you what is T right now, but just keep it for common understanding that is a T test. But in the subsequent classes, I will be telling you about the distributions as well, what will be the distributions, like why we use the term T. And I will also tell you why we have not used the value of P that is 2 points above, that is one tail, why we have taken two tail. These are the things which are in my mind. I'll tell you like step by step. Okay, now let's example. What I need to do, I need to say I have more than two samples. I have more than two vendors. Say three vendors, three samples. Okay.
Sir,
if I have three, yeah.
So what about one sample key test if we have?
Yeah, because that capability is not in Excel. So if I'll say data analysis, that capability is not in Excel. One sample t-test is not in Excel. So that's why I have not explained you one sample t-test. But once we, so I have told you what is one sample t test, but so the output will be similar to this only. But since the capability is not in Excel, so once we start working on Python, then I will tell you how to solve this in Python. This cannot be solved in Excel.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now, when we have more than two samples, say three samples, okay, we will go with ANOVA. So condition one says, null hypothesis says, vendor one equal to vendor two equal to vendor three, and alternate says when alternate either any one of the vendor is not equal. This is known as ANOVA. So that's the thing that we will solve with the help of ANOVA. So ANOVA is again a thing which we will be covering. So before this, let me tell you what is one tail test. What is two tail and what is one tail? So guys, let me tell you. Here the null we have taken is weight is equal to 57 gram. So here the null we have taken as weight is equal to 57 gram. Alternate we have taken as weight not equal to 57. But if I'll take weight less than 57, there can be this condition as well.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Or the condition can be weight
greater than
57 gram. There can be three conditions.
Null case, sir, or alternate case?
Null is equal to 57. It will always remain equal to 57. First condition of alternate is either the weight is less than 57 gram. Another condition of null alternate can be weight greater than 57 gram. Third condition can be weight equal to 57 gram. Weight not equal to 57.
So, sir, null will always be what we want it to be, right?
Yeah, null always says it is same. So whatever sample is saying, it is same. Or null always says it is same. Okay. Alternate always says it is not same. Either it's less than. Yeah.
Basically, null means whatever expectation is.
Yeah. Alternate can be different. Alternate is either it is less than, it is greater than, or it is not equal. With me?
Yes.
For alternate, we can have three conditions. Till now, I have only tested this condition. This one, this condition. This or this condition. Are you with me? Or this condition, or A here, it will be vendor one. So null is vendor one equal to vendor two. Here it is vendor one less than vendor two. Vendor one greater than vendor two, or vendor one not equal to vendor two. Here we have only tested this condition with the help of two tail test. Okay.
Yes.
So now, in case we need to test these two conditions, then these are being tested with one tail test. Okay. So here, so this is known as two tail. Just see how many tails
This has one is left, one is right. Less than, greater than, two tail. This is one tail. That is greater than. This is also one tail. These are not very accurate. Two tail is comparatively more accurate. This is known as left tail. This is known as right tail. This is known as two tail. Are you with me?
Yes.
So how do we decide left and right tail?
So where the tail of this arrow is it on the left or right?
Okay.
Considering the same position as we have in null, V1 on left side, V2 on left side. If the tail is on left, then left tail. Tail is on right, then it is right tail. If tail is on both sides, it is two. With me, anybody, any doubt?
Sorry, if you compare more than two samples, means you go for ANOVA.
I haven't explained you yet.
Yeah, sir. You just tell me about that. But when to use, I mean, ANCOVA, sir. There is one more concept I have seen in the data analysis sheet.
So analysis of covariance of something. Even I haven't used ANCOVA yet.
I have seen the term in the data.
So let me search it out. So to be very frank, I haven't used ANCOVA yet. So let me. Obviously, ANOVA is the letter C, which stands for covariance, like ANOVA, analysis of covariance. Okay. A single continuous response variable, and ANOVA is used to describe analysis single response variable, continuous versus no factors. Okay. So there are two things. One is variance, and second is covariance. So I haven't explained you what is covariance. Covariance is variances with respect to one variable only. Covariance is when it comes to understanding the variance of two variables, that then it is covariance. I'll explain you. I'll read it and explain you because even I haven't worked on ANCOVA yet. Okay, guys.
Sir, for
For
doing a two-tailed test, it is not necessary that we have two different samples, right?
Come again, I didn't get you. For doing a two-tailed test, it is not necessary
that we have two different samples.
So in all these conditions which I am telling you, for two sample, so this is two sample t-test or one sample t-test. If you're going with two sample t-test, we should have the two samples.
No, sir, I'm talking about the two-tail t-test.
In two-tail, the thing is whenever you're measuring the condition, the first is vendor one equal to vendor two, and second is if the vendor one not equal to vendor two, if you want to measure that, then we will be going with the two-tail output from statistics. If we are measuring, trying to measure any of this condition as alternate condition, then we will go with this tail, one tail.
But sir, we can perform two-tail t-test with only one vendor also, right?
No.
When not equal to 57.
Yeah, two-tail we can perform with one vendor. So that is the thing. So that depends on a sample. If we have a one sample, then one sample t-test and all these three conditions will be same. All these three conditions will be same. If we are going with two sample, then we can perform two sample t-test and all these three conditions will be same.
Okay, sir.
Are you with me?
Yeah, understood, sir.
Come again? I didn't get you.
Understood.
Okay. Anybody else? Any doubt?
Sir, that means that depending on our condition, whether what we have taken as an alternate, we go for p-value, whether one tail or two tail.
Yes, you're right. And the slogan remains same.
Okay. Okay.
So the crux is that you have to remember this proof and the conditions. Then you will be able to solve it. So ANOVA is a bit more tricky than this. Do you want me to cover ANOVA today or I will leave it to tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
It's okay. So what are the topics that have been left right now? Can anybody tell me?
Sir, the T-test and P-test, we will explain now later.
T-test and?
T-test, Z-test.
These are the
hello.
Yeah, so I will explain you. So the topics,
sir, you will explain also the P. What is P?
This is the P value, but I will tell you,
sir, the basic behind the P value.
I will tell you that is the probability value. I'll tell you when consider probability.
Level of significance.
Yes, that's what I'm going
to say. So level of significance is 0.05. The 95 is the confidence level or the level of significance.
But how do we decide that? We might have to take different level of significance for different conditions, right?
So okay. Let me tell you. Answer this right now. So this is an industrial standard that whenever you go with 95% confidence. But in case you are trying to measure anything, then you go till 99%. But you can only go to 99% when you have enough large number of samples.
Sir, what do you mean when you say 99%
or 95%? So here I have taken alpha is 0.05.
Yes.
So why I have taken this value is 0.05? Because when I have done this, so the value is 0.05. Did you see it?
Yes, sir.
So that's why I have taken 0.05. If I make this value 0.01, then this value will also be 0.01 here.
Then what is alpha, sir? I thought it's numeric number.
So that's what I have been explaining, right? It is alpha.
So the p value should be based on the alpha we set.
Alpha value. Okay. So alpha, this alpha is the error rate. So if you see a statistics that I want to be 95% confident about the problem, then stats, then you will take alpha as
5.5.
If you want to say, I want to be 99% confident, then you take alpha as 0.01. But here, the sample size should be very large. Not 30, 40 samples. It should be at least 50, 60, 70% of the population. There's no benchmark around it, but it should be sufficiently large. Here, you can work with a comparatively less sample size. This is the industry standard. When you work on hypothesis testing, this is the industry standard. That's why when we went here and we said this, it automatically came as 0.05.
So sir, who makes the decision regarding what should be the level of significance? Whether it should be 0.05 or greater than that or less than that.
The criticality of the problem you are solving. So let's example, you are trying to measure the parts of aeroplane, whether they are fine or not. Then even 99% confidence is not worth it. You will go with the entire population measurement, 100% confidence.
Clinical trials, then do we need to select that alpha as 0.01?
Yeah. So in critical situations, the alpha is minimum 0.01.
Okay.
So this actually depends on the break even between the cost that you are incurring and the significance you need. So let's example, you're measuring the weight of toffees, candies. 90% is fine. On the other side, if we're measuring the weight of gold coins, 99% is also less. The thing is, but when you're measuring the gold coins, so what if you're taking 99%, you should have enough number of samples. You should have enough number of manpower to collect that samples. But in case you are measuring with going with the 90%, you can randomly take any of the samples, say weight of the toffees or the candies which are.
Alpha is chance of going wrong.
Yeah, error rate.
Okay.
Sir, you also told about one-way ANOVA, two-way ANOVA, ANCOVA like.
So ANOVA, ANCOVA. So tomorrow I will cover ANOVA, and I will take ANCOVA as well or anything. So I will explain you later, but not right now. ANOVA, if I'll try to explain now, then it will be, you guys will be lost for the concept that I will. But later on, during the subsequent classes, I will be telling you each and every.
Okay.
Sir, there is a term called paired sample. What it is?
Sorry, which term?
Paired sample, sir.
Paired. Okay. Yes. Okay. Paired is when you are trying to measure before and after. So let's say, example, you have given COVID vaccine to 50 people. So what are their parameters before and what are their parameters after? The sample or the object on which any of the thing needs to be tested is same. Then it is paired t-test.
Okay, sir.
So anybody any doubt till now?
No, sir. I have a doubt. Actually, how could we conclude the data collected, I mean samples collected are accurate, and what should be done if the data samples collected containing, I mean having errors?
So the thing is, there is a simple formula to it. That is random sampling, which says that you should do a sampling where each and every sample has equal chances of getting selected. So let's say example, so the normal ticketing system that you do, you put the numbers and on a slip and you put it in a bucket, and where every number has equal chance to be picked. The same way we play game tambola. So that is known as correct sampling, random sampling. So this statistics is based on every time probability. So every sample has an equal probability to be picked. Every sample that you're picking should be random. It should not be biased. So if you guys would have seen a lottery system of some of the things, what they do, they, instead of random sampling, they do a biased sampling, because of which people have lost the trust in many of the lottery systems. Okay, so that is known as biased sampling. But if every time it goes with a random sampling, then every person who has failed, who has filed for that draw, has an equal chance of it. That is random sampling. So that's a generalized answer or common answer to the question that you ask. And that is a always universal answer.
So just one question I want to ask.
Yeah.
So when we'll be doing machine learning, so the like the example which we have taken right now,
mm-hmm.
Is the example of regression modeling, right?
Mm-hmm. So the regression.
So
modeling,
these are the steps.
Yeah, please continue.
Yeah, so these are the steps for regression modeling, right?
No. These are not the steps for regression modeling, because when the regression modeling will come, it will give you the p value of every coefficient. So there we need to decide whether the p is high or not high. We need to accept a particular coefficient or not. So there, this will be used. So hypothesis testing, then I will not be telling you what is hypothesis. I will just be picking the p-value with the random slogan which I have.
So this will be used to determine which variables to be considered for regression, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Guys,
one more doubt. Actually,
sir, hello.
Yeah, please ask. Yeah, so anybody, a person was asking.
In the tabular column, yeah, sir. And the result, I mean, analysis result you have shown in the tabular column, right, sir? Mean, variance, observations, and all. So we taken into the account that p test two tail, I mean, p value of two tail. So there is one more parameter called p test one tail. So as you said, one tail means either it will be the less than or equal to or greater than or, I mean, less than or v1 less than or less than v2 or v1 greater than v2. So yeah. Here, how should we conclude that the p test one tail is either less than or greater than?
It's for both.
Okay. So it compares said, with the mean.
That's why I said it is not as accurate as two tails.
Okay. And one more doubt. Suppose we have the data of let's say for example 3,000 samples, and we taken random of 30 values. So what happens if we and value as null in the 30 samples, and how should we approach it, null values?
Come again, I didn't get to.
Actually, we have around 3,000 samples. So we have taken 30 samples randomly. So, and if what should be done if we have null values in the random samples?
So null values will not be considered as the sample.
So we need to not be considered, but while process, are we analyzing the data, it should be filled with any fixed values like that or not. We just ignore the null values and move on to the available values.
Yeah, we should ignore the null values. We should not include the null values, and we will go with the values that are actually available.
Okay, sir.
Okay, guys, so tomorrow we will again meet at 8:30 and I'll cover ANOVA and some more concepts of some distributions which I'll be telling you. So these distributions will not be as explained as Z distribution, but I will telling you some of the distributions that are commonly used and what are the purposes. So the T distribution is used to measure the means. The Z distribution is also used to measure the means. I'll tell you the n number of key terms that are basically used and what are the purposes. Okay, guys. So we'll meet tomorrow at 8:30.
Okay.
So you will be getting this sheet in your LMS portal tomorrow to revise in case you want.
Okay, sir.
Thank you very much, guys. Good night.
Okay, sir.
Good night.
Night.
Thank you. Thanks for attention.